Hi, it's Kaitlin Joshua, and I'm reading an excerpt from my short story, Love and Vera. When I got home that night, I sat at the windowsill with a cup of chamomile and Basie, the old Irish hound, snoring in my lap. I figured he was chasing something in his dreams. His breath sounded frantic. I could hear Yora in the other room packing her lunch for the next day, and then the violent snap of the light switch, and finally her bedroom door slammed closed. I shouldn't have snapped, but those lunchtime specials made me crazy. I wished I was the sort of person who always made sense, but I've always gone with what I feel. I guess that's why I kept working there at the receptionist desk. It felt like it was right for me. Even when looking at Dr. Wright and Mrs. Wright in their noon ritual felt like trying to breathe with no air. I sighed and started doing my hair in the dark. Twist after twist lined my head. I didn't usually do so many, but the rhythm let me think. The dead ends of my curls came away in my fingers, and by the time I was done, dozens of curls papered my fingertips. I hadn't told Yora, hadn't told anyone but Basie, and even then only when he was sleeping and I was speaking on whispered breath. He kissed me. I had breathed as I lay on the floor, newly arrived home. My work shoes were still on, pinching my toes and surely leaving dried leaves in the carpet. I'd known Yora would fuss later, but hadn't cared much. He'd kissed me. I'd let him. I pulled the sleeve of my blouse upwards. I thought I might feel the indentations where his fingers had been. My back felt like it had hollows where he had pulled me close. I bet someone could smell his shaving cream on my lips. When we broke away, I gasped, and he bit his bottom lip. For months, we carried on like that. 8 and a half to be exact. I know, I counted. For 8 and a half months, I got to feel like one of those women on the cover of a romance novel. There's nothing in a book except the words on the page, and that's how I like it. Everything all laid out where I can see it. We got to the last page 2 days before Christmas. I was fixing the holly arrangements above the door when he came in from the snow. He kissed me with frost still on his lips and the trace of a beard lining his chin. I tasted the bits of snow, felt warm. He looked at me hairline to chin, bit his bottom lip, and pulled me close. Felt like love to me. 16 hours later, his son was born. He had not looked at me that way since. He had not even spoken my name. Ellis was 3 and a half months. I knew. I kept counting. When I finally stumbled into my room around midnight, I ran sunflower seed oil down each of my twists, donned my pink silk scarf, and stared into the ceiling's crown molding until my body tricked my mind into resting. Yora was gone when I woke, off to greet the early carpool children. I left my apology note stuck to the microwave. 2 weeks later, after Yora forgave me but before she stopped looking at me with those sad eyes, Miss Vera came back. I wanted to ask why she didn't just make an appointment. The town was small, the people were few, and the number of people who could afford a doctor every time their knees got stiff were fewer still. But she only ever pulled up in that truck utterly unannounced. Mama said, "That's just how Vera rolls. Popping up when she feels like it." Mama said a lot of things about Miss Vera, and I just wondered what that woman could have possibly done to be so dear to her. My whole life she came around my childhood home. I wasn't old enough when Mama was alive to be privy to grown-up conversations, but I did wonder what they talked about all that time. I never saw her talk much to anybody else, and she never sat on the parent-teacher boards or took Letitia to Sunday school. And when you're quiet and semi-invisible like that, you get to be the stuff of legend, of whispers. On the school bus, a new story at every stoplight. She's a witch. She's a what? She's a ghost. Letitia got the brunt of it. My mama said your mama's an adult-er. She's going to H-E-L-L. They spelled them out all careful, because otherwise they'd get tripped up on all those words that didn't even belong to them. I'm sure it'll just be a few minutes, Miss Vera. Mrs. Wright arrived a few moments later. The ritual. I was having tomato soup and cornbread and a fat slice of lemon meringue pie with my show. But it was different that day. Dr. Wright swept in, asked about the baby, kissed her goodbye, and promised Vera he'd be out to collect her soon, all in a blur. His wife watched from her corner near the door until the tails of his coat disappeared through the clinic. With that, I heard the careful tap of his heels ringing louder and louder in my eardrums. "Hey, Natalie. It's Natalie, right?" "Yes." "No, no, no, no." Mind if I see the mail? She smiled brightly for a millisecond before her mouth twisted up into a tight knot. She said it lightly, but it still felt like a trick. I hadn't known if letting her see Dr. Wright's mail was legal, but I didn't think I was in much of a position to demand options. As she stood there scanning letters, I got a good look at her for the first time in ages. Her dress was white, with a starched collar and a long line of buttons. Her lipstick was a jaunty pink you could probably find in the department store catalogs. Her rouge made her brown cheeks dollish. The look almost covered everything, but I could still see the jut of her stomach where the baby used to be. Setting powder was creased into the frown lines at the corners of her mouth. I wondered what you'll see in me if you look too long. I guess she hadn't found what she was looking for. This is silly. She slapped the envelope back onto the counter and pulled her arm stiff to her side. Her cheeks were hot and flushed. I just wanted to know. She cleared her throat and tugged the collar away from her neck. I could see the pale brown streaks where her makeup had stained it. I was just checking to see if... Well, you know what? Whatever. I'm already here doing this. I'll say it. Her voice dropped an octave. Is my husband seeing somebody else at this office? You skip the flowers one time, that one time, and this is what happens. No, ma'am. Will you let me know? Woman to woman, I'd appreciate it. She snatched her purse from the counter and slammed the door on her way out. It felt like my heart was going to just fall right out of me. Miss Vera, you can come on back. Dr. Wright held out his hand towards Vera, but frowned when he saw his wife's red convertible nearly hit the mailbox on its way out. Tiana just now leaving? He said to no one in particular. Certainly not to me. I hoped he was nervous. He deserved it. He snapped out of it just as fast. Miss Vera, you get that medicine like I said to? Their voices were too faint to hear before I noticed my hand shaking. Sweat lined the back of my dress and the bridge of my nose under my glasses, and I reached for one of the patient files scattered across my desk to use as a fan. Perhaps not the most ethical use of a patient's medical file, but I hadn't been making the best decisions by anyone's calculations as of late. I wish I had said, yes, ma'am. She's always gone on a red dress and her perfume smells like sin. You better leave before he does. I also wished I had said, it's me, it's love. If only one lie could have been true. Several minutes passed, but it felt like only half a moment before Dr. Wright's voice boomed back in my eardrums. Now you make sure you're getting enough rest. I don't want any more of this cough. Call your daughter to do the chores if you get too tired, okay? And you really ought to think about moving in with all this trouble. Dr. Wright didn't follow Miss Vera out that time, only held the door open for her as long as it took for her to shuffle through before letting it swing closed behind her back. I stared down into my lunch. The soup made my stomach curl. Miss Vera dropped her file on the desk in front of me, and I suddenly remembered what my job description was. I combed through all the pages, but I couldn't find the list of prescriptions I needed. I'll call your medicine in for you just as soon as I find them. By the time you get to the pharmacy, it should be ready, okay? You need anything else? I said, without looking up. You know what you call something you don't have the words for? Ms. Vera said. She popped her gum all loud. Huh? Nothing. That's what you call it. I don't know if I follow what you're talking about, Ms. Vera. This got something to do with what Dr. Wright said. The mass of papers on my desk grew as I searched the other files. Instead of talking right then, she let the moment spread out. The silence was too long. I looked up. Etched into her lips was something like a lopsided smile. Finally, she reached over the desk to pat my hand, twice. For the first time ever, I noticed all her freckles. Ha! I suspect it's got something to do with what old Doc hasn't said. She pushed her glasses as far up her nose as they could go. I'll see Hector tomorrow. She padded lightly from the office, smacking bubblegum the whole way. Her truck was at the stoplight before I wondered how she knew. And right now, as I sit in my window thinking the past few months over, I wonder how I didn't. Funny thing is how life goes on after something like Miss Vera. She comes in 2 weeks later to tell Dr. Wright Letitia's finally moving her out, and that she'll be gone by morning. We go back to her old routine of silence, except this time I say goodbye and she says, say hello to your mama for me tonight. Vera comes home all excited, new ring on her finger, and soon after it's just me and Basie in the house up past her bedtime. Dr. Wright carries Ellis into work on his shoulders. Mrs. Wright sends letters that say the kind of things you learn for a spelling bee, like separation of assets and dissolution. I guess there really was a woman in a red dress. Or maybe Mrs. Wright knows the truth about me. She gives me very sweet smiles all the same. She and Dr. Wright sit on different pews on Sunday mornings, and all the church mothers pretend not to notice. And when I write about love and Miss Vera, I make $25 from the Romeo and Juliet Southeast Regional Romantic Fiction Competition. I figure that's enough to make it work until I get hired somewhere else. I quit. Some new young thing takes my place. Ellis turns one, and I let the new florist in town romance me with seed packages and kisses out in the open. Finally, something I've got the words for. Hey, Mama, and God, I see what you meant. Love,